It's no secret that getting your suspension tuned right to suit your race car can make or break a lap time, but I think it's fair to say there's a lot of misinformation and misunderstanding about what makes a racing damper work properly. We're here with Andre from Modal Suspension to find out a little bit more about their recently released racing damper. So, for a start, racing dampers, they've been around for decades, and I feel that from the outside looking in, this is a relatively established sort of product range. It's relatively mature. Why is it that you chose to develop your own bespoke damper from the ground up?
So at DNA, at least, we're always, I guess, at the mercy of some of the things that people purchase off the shelf. So my kind of rule of thumb is, if your car is not off the shelf, you can't put an off-the-shelf damper in it. So what we found that we were doing a lot is, you know, taking these off-the-shelf products, opening them up, modifying the valving and the spring rates to suit the given application. And essentially from there, the owner of the car would be up for a little bit more than what they would have if we just built something from scratch to begin with. Because you're buying a product and then you're paying for it to be modified.
So you're not talking here about sort of basic products either. You're talking about high level, maybe from the likes of Ohlins or something like that. Known quality race suspension manufacturers.
Yeah, that's correct. These products are they're given off the shelf. They're already valved. They're already gassed and oiled and everything. So you need to undo all of that and take two steps back in order to then take three steps forward.
If we look at something like the dampening of these shocks, you know, sort of what do we need to know about how that's set up from the likes of an off-the-shelf manufacturer compared to what you do?
So put yourself in the shoes of an engineer at one of these companies. They're being told to design the valving of this damper to suit anyone who may buy it. So if, let's say, you gave a damper to someone who had, you know, never driven a race car before and they went full hard in the rear and full soft at the front, they might make the car, you know, quite uneasy in certain situations. So where we come in is we're working with people who have driven race cars before, have built, you know, considerably fast cars, and then we're giving them valving that'll actually work the tire where it needs to. We're controlling the settings that those dampers are being put at, and we're allowing them to work in a window that we've calculated we know that works. So that's what gives us, I guess, the edge over anything that would come out of the box.
I guess looking at this as maybe, let's say, devil's advocate, obviously if you've got a racing damper where the compression and rebound damping is adjustable, then I would think that on face value you could get that into a window to suit your car, but you're saying that's not necessarily the case?
Correct. We are always chasing the tire. Almost anything that we do, we're always looking at the tire to make sure we've done a good job. So when it comes to, you know, that example you've just given, the range in which you're allowed to operate in may not be suited to a semi-slick. It may not be suited to a slick tire. So yes, there is some play, but 9 times out of 10, going back to what I've said, safe is not necessarily fast. So they may give you a very small compression window and quite a large extension or rebound window, which keeps the car safe, but doesn't necessarily generate lap time.
Okay, so I guess from the driver's perspective, sitting in the seat, and I'm talking here about a driver that's experienced, not an absolute amateur, how does the driver know when the damping is wrong, and what will they notice when it's on point?
So looking at a damper that, let's say, is not to suit whatsoever, let's say you've got something off the shelf and you've got a car with high aero and slick tires, that damper and spring package are not necessarily going to generate the forces you need to control that slick tire. So a driver may feel hopping or skipping through a corner, for example, may feel a bit of uneasiness or instability under heavy braking. And those sort of signs usually point towards the damper, the spring and damper package not being in the window. Whereas, let's say you have something that's been valved and sprung to suit, you may find that, let's say it's low grip out there, you may find that the car has a little bit of a slide to it rather than a hop and a skip as that grip starts to go away. So there are a few things that you can look out for.
Coming back one step, talking about the damper itself, obviously we have the valving, which you've touched on, but then we have the spring rate. And one of the more common questions we get asked is, how do I choose a spring rate to suit my car? Now, that's probably a bit of a loaded question, but can you talk us through the high-level view of what you need to know to choose a spring rate?
So the spring for us is, we've always viewed a spring as a dumb product. You know, it's one job, and its job is to hold the weight of the car compress and extend. So for us, the actual spring rate is not something that we look at. Initially, what we look at is what we call the ride frequency of the car. So we have a look at that, and based on the aero level of the car, the tire that it's running, and a few other bits and pieces, we'll choose a ride frequency that we believe is going to be in the window for that car. From there, we do a series of calculations, and then it will say, okay, for a ride frequency of 1.5 hertz, you need a spring rate of 8 kilos. And then that's where the spring comes in.
So really the ride frequency is key. Once we know the ride frequency we are targeting, there's no real debate here. There is a spring rate that will provide that ride frequency for the vehicle.
Exactly. So you might say, you know, for this particular vehicle, I'd like it to be sprung between 1.5 hertz and 1.65 hertz. So you get your range, you go, okay, this car should be happy between an 8 kilo spring and a 9.5 kilo spring. So then based on our experience for things that we've tried at the track, we might lean on that a little bit and say, okay, for an Evo with the all-wheel drive system that it's got, let's go on the softer side for this particular one. And if we find in our, you know, the thermal imaging testing that we do on our tires, if we find that, okay, hey, might need a little bit more, we can then step the spring rate up, but we will always find the window very, pretty quickly.
Can you just talk a little bit more about that thermal imaging that you just referenced, how you're using that, what it actually is, and how you know when it's right?
So thermal imaging is, again, it's something like many engineering tests where it's garbage in, garbage out. So you need to make sure that you're using the right equipment and you're taking your measurements at the right time in order to make sure that the results you're seeing are indicative of what's happening. So we use a thermal imaging camera. Some people might use an infrared sensor and things like that to look at the surface temp of the tire. But otherwise, the other thing is a probe. So physically putting a pin or a probe into the tire and measuring the carcass temperature. And what we're looking for there is the inside, the middle, and the outside, or maybe even a few more points across the tire to see if there's a linear gradient across that tire, for example, if it's higher in the middle, higher on the outside. And basically also looking at the maximum temperature reached. You know, a slick tire needs to be, call it 70 degrees plus in order to start generating grip. Are we reaching that 70 degrees? If not, we need to look at the spring and damper.
Now, that sort of technology, that technique is also used, I would say, almost primarily to help with car setup and what I'm talking about here, camber and tire pressure. So how do we then layer on another element in terms of spring and dampening and not confuse all of the parameters together?
So those two things really do work hand in hand. So if you had a car that was sprung extremely soft, let's say it was below the ride frequency that it required, you might find that you need to run a lot of camber on that car in order to generate the grip that you need. However, all you're doing is band-aiding the problem is the car's too soft. So it's rolling over to the outside of the tire faster than it should. So let's say you go, okay, you know, the car feels really good. A driver is typically talking about balance. So you can have a very balanced car that does not generate lab time or is coming, you know, bottom five, for example.
Balanced but still slow.
Exactly. So typically there, if I have to put a whole heap of camber in a car to make it work, then I'm taking away from my footprint in the braking zone, number one. And then number two, is the car just too soft? Maybe I can run less camber but stiffen the thing up. But again, every platform and every tire and every sort of aero package will require something slightly different, but that's where all of our calculations come in.
Okay, a lot of what we talk about as race drivers is the car balance, which you've referred to a number of times here. So essentially, how the car is to drive for the driver, is it neutral? Is it pushing or understeering? Or is it loose or oversteering? Can we also use spring rate? And I'm talking here, really, it comes back to, of course, ride frequency, a change of ride frequency at just one end of the car to affect a change in balance.
Look, I've always been open to exploring things like that, provided we've ticked other boxes, such as we're happy with the tire pressures, we're happy with the alignment. Now, as I mentioned, we will usually find the window. Now, that window might be, you know, let's say an 8 kilo spring to a 10 kilo spring. If we find that in a lot of places when we are missing that balance, but we're happy with what the tire is showing us, then okay, sure. If the rear is happy between 8 and 10 kilos, let's go from 8 to 9 and let's give that a try. And if we find an overall balance improvement to the car, happy days. But in order to prove that, we may stiffen the shock up first, we may raise the ride height. But if we find we're running stupid rake numbers in a car in order to make it turn, then it might allude to, hey, maybe we've got to look at the spring again.
So essentially, if you've got that calculation of the ride frequency and hence the spring rate that you think you're going to need, and you're finding that you're way out of that ballpark, that's indicating there's a bigger problem. Go back to basics, look at the rest of the package.
Correct. That's a simple way to put it. I think the precursor to that is physically calculating the ride frequency or even choosing a ride frequency is not straightforward whatsoever. And you do rely on a lot of experience and some very specific equations and obviously variables that we put into those equations to get that number. But yes, as far as a step-by-step process is concerned, you would look at the ride frequency and then typically calculate the rest of the car from there.
All right, let's talk a little bit about the construction of the damper itself, because there's a variety of materials that are used. Pros and cons, and what have you chosen for your particular product?
So looking at first the construction of a particular damper, so looking at the McPherson strut, we believe the best way to do that is an inverted monotube. It allows us to still run a smaller shaft rather than a large 22, 24 mil shaft that you might see in some entry-level dampers. It also allows us to still have quite a large oil and gas volume in the damper, but also the front end of these cars, especially, you know, ERS's car here, the front end is going to see so much load. So having a steel tube for the body and a steel a strut leg allows us to kind of cater for those force requirements. So that's for the front of the car. And the rear of the car, being just a standard monotube, we run an aluminium tube with a 16 mil shaft in this case.
So this is a unique aspect of the McPherson strut as opposed to a double wishbone or a multi-link, because you are reliant on the rigidity of the damper itself to support the wheel as well, correct?
Exactly. So a good way to look at it is, you know, every object on the planet has 6 degrees of freedom, up, down, left, right, and yaw, pitch, things like that. The geometry in the rear of this car, the wheel is allowed to move in one direction, which is up and down, and you've got certain arms to cater for stopping it moving in other directions. With the McPherson strut, it actually has to handle two of those, the steering aspect and the up and down aspect. So there's a lot more load going in a McPherson strut damper than there would be in, let's say, the rear damper of this car.
And when we're talking about damping, we've got compression and rebounds, and quite often we'll find at the entry level or lower levels, we might have a one-way adjustable damper. Then we might go to adjustable, independently adjustable bump and rebound. And then in racing shocks, maybe four or five-way adjustable with high and low speed and even blow-off valves for running curbs. Is it a case, particularly at the entry level, where the driver may not be that experienced, that less adjustment is better?
Yes, I definitely I'm not opposed to that whatsoever. So if you look at, let's say, certain one make series like Porsche Carrera Cup, the dampers that are in the current gen Carrera Cup car are non-adjustable. So there's no dial on it whatsoever. And as I'm sure you can appreciate, there are extremely experienced teams and engineers running these cars. So we've been fortunate enough to work in the Carrera Cup field and currently work in Porsche Michelin Sprint Challenge. And the dampers that we use, they are in the window. So we're quite happy with the sort of damping that they offer. And we typically will then tune the chassis in order to get what we need. So for sure, if you hand a four-way adjustable crazy GT3 damper to someone who's only just getting into, only starting to build their race car, they'd be absolutely inundated and would be quite difficult to point out. But if we designed a damper for that person, did our calculations, accounted for their inexperience, let's say, and had a package that was a little bit more on the easy side, let's say, not as knife edge or fast, we could give them something where they could have a simple dial to increase and stiffen the damping to the conditions, but we would dictate the window that they could work in. But provided we've calculated that, they've got nothing to worry about.
It makes sense. In terms of racing dampers, the other thing we quite often see is external reservoirs. And I'm just interested if you could give us a little bit more insight into what these achieve and why they are common in racing dampers.
So there's, I guess, a two-pronged approach to this. One is having an independent canister actually allows you to increase the adjustment on a particular damper. So instead of a one-way or a two-way, as soon as you have a canister, you actually can then go to a three-way, for example. You can have a high-speed and low-speed blow-off in that canister. Now, the other option is, for certain cars, you may be extremely restricted on the packaging with that geometry, so the damper's quite small. In order to increase the travel in that particular damper, we can run a canister, put the separating piston that's normally in the damper in the canister, and all of a sudden have a heap more travel in such a tighter package.
So just a lot more flexibility there with the tuning of it.
Exactly, and it also allows, you know, we can run a bit more oil in the damper, which is great for cooling and things like that. Not a massive consideration on circuit cars, but of course rally cars and rally applications, the damper's working a lot harder, it does heat up a fair bit.
I guess the $1 million question here is, moving to something like you're producing bespoke, one-off, purposely valved and sprung for a particular car and application, coming from something that might still not be a factory production damper, something that's already a performance racing damper, what sort of difference in lap times are we likely to see? We're talking a couple of tenths, are we talking a half a second, or we're talking a second or more?
So we're pretty fortunate enough that we do get to test this, a lot of back-to-back stuff. So 9 times out of 10, someone will come to us with an off-the-shelf product. And when we test it in our dyno or we have a look at the valving, again, it's safe, but not fast. So consider, we always consider the experience of the driver when we do valve these things. And we've typically seen around Eastern Creek that we can see a gain in the seconds. So we're not just looking at a couple of tenths or a half a second gain here or there, but typically when we put the damper in there, even if we don't pair it with a setup from DNA, we typically see over a second in lap time gain.
I mean, that is a massive gain, and people will be spending thousands and thousands on other aspects of their car, aero, engine power, braking, to try and get that sort of performance. So it makes sense. If you can get that sort of a gain, it's definitely an easy path to go down. Now, if people want to find out more about the product or perhaps purchase, get something set up for their car, how can they do so?
So just before I answer that, going back on what you said, the important thing there is, people will spend their money on their aero and other bits and pieces, but your car is made of millions of parts and only 4 of them touch the ground. So the way to look at it is, a good quality set of suspension that's been fit for purpose is actually going to help those aero devices work and do their job. So they do work hand in hand. But if you know people want to learn more about the dampers, they can look us up on social media through either DNA Autosport or looking us up on social media, Modal Suspension, M-O-D-A-L, Modal Suspension.
Awesome. That's really great. Thank you very much for your time. Great to get some insight into the product, and it's made me start second guessing the suspension we've got fitted to our car. So thanks again.
No dramas, and hopefully we can work together on that car as well.
Cheers.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.